We got some big NA LCS predictions because we're only a couple days away from the spring split teeing off, and the Riot released a teaser today that was very underwhelming. It was just players looking at the cameras and then various city landscapes. The EU one was way better.
Oh, EU one was better. The one for Worlds was better. Even the champion cinematic for season 8 was better than this one. Way better. This one didn't even have Lucian and Thresh.
You gotta have that duel. But yeah, it was a little lackluster, honestly. But we're gonna go through, give you some rookie picks, MVP picks, who's gonna win the split, maybe some week one matchups. We're gonna go through all that. So make sure you're sending in your questions throughout the day as well. Who you think should be MVP, any questions about the upcoming split. We will get to all those Q&A sections later on in the show. And we also got a special little tease for you later in the show that I'm not gonna give any more details on.
Please don't. I'm waiting. Fingertips on needles.
That sounds terrible. That sounds painful.
I don't know. What's the expression?
I don't know. Let's get into the rookies. There's a...
Pins and needles.
That's what it is. Fingers on needles just sounds graphic.
That's torture.
Yeah, that's just torture.
I apologize for that image.
Rookies, you look at last split, it was Mike Young versus nobody, and then Niski kind of came in towards the end. Heading into 2018, there's actually... You got a decent class. You got guys like Onda, Licorice, and definitely those are going to be the main guys. Maybe someone pops up from an academy team. But those are the main three heading into 2018. Who do you like for rookie of the split?
For me, it has to be Licorice on C9. I think that Licorice in the top lane for C9 is going to be an absolutely great addition for him. Sure, he's not up to the same level that Impact is, that you're trying to replace, but I feel like Licorice is going to be someone that we can see as an NA talent to stand up with the likes of Hauncer in the top lane. Someone who has proven to be up in that top level of North American talent, and he will be able to absorb pressure and hold out on his own, I believe, in the top lane for C9, which will allow Svenskeren to be cooperating and working with guys like Jensen, working with Sneaky and Smoothie in the bot lane. I think that this is going to be a really well-rounded out C9 team led by the rookie Licorice in the top lane.
Here's the thing with Licorice. I just don't think he's going to get the opportunity that a lot of these other guys are going to get on these teams. You look at a guy like Onda, he's a big question mark, but he's going to be very featured on that FlyQuest roster. He's either got the opportunity to really excel, or he's got a guy like Shrimp on the academy team behind him who might just steal his spot if he's struggling. For Licorice, I mean, guys like Svenskeren, Jensen, and Sneaky, you're rarely, if ever, probably going to be the featured carry on that squad. You saw in a lot of those highlights, and in a lot of his Challenger Series games, he's playing stuff like the Camille, the Fiora, to get guys ahead and just carry those games. I don't know if he's going to have that same opportunity on Cloud9, which is why I don't think he'll be able to take home that rookie this split. I'm looking at a guy like Deathly on Golden Guardians. I know that team's not great. That's probably a bottom two, bottom three tier team, but who's gonna carry on that team? High? Listen, I love High. He's a great shot caller. He's a legend of the North American scene, but we know his mechanics have fallen off lately. He's not a top tier mid laner. Lorlo, I don't know. He's been good. He's been okay in his time on Liquid, but I feel like Deathly is going to be a main carry on this team along with Contracts. He's just going to get that opportunity.
I feel like you're right when you're talking about Deathly in this type of way, when you're saying that he will be more or less the star on the Golden Guardians. And I think an important factor to look at of where his success might also come from is Matt as his support. A lot of people are overlooking Matt, but I think that Matt is actually quite a mechanically gifted support. And I feel like, you know, he just didn't quite mesh during his time on Team Liquid. And I think that he's had a good off season. And I think that him combined with Deathly could lead to an explosive bot lane duo. I still like my pick of Licorice. I still think that, you know, he's going to be that rock for C9 in the top lane. Yeah, you're saying that he might not be the one carrying, and I think that's true, but I think he's going to be a steady performer there and a very easy pick to make for Rookie of the Split if no one else is necessarily spectacular.
Yeah, I mean, if guys like Deathly and Anda don't impress or kind of struggle in their debut splits, then yeah, it'll probably go to Licorice because he won't have as much pressure on him. And I do love Licorice. Hey. I just don't think the player will win Rookie of the Split.
Just strawberry, or do you like black licorice too?
Black licorice is disgusting.
Oh, no. It's
terrible.
I like black licorice.
I don't want it.
I'm a fan of licorice. That's all.
Anytime you get the jujubes that are that flavor,
But see, that's...
I don't want them.
That's why I win, because I eat all the Jujubes. I get everyone's extras.
Oh, the leftovers that people don't want, that they put in their mouth because they thought it was a grape. Grape flavored, they spit it back
in. No.
You don't want to eat
no,
that
thank
stuff.
You.
Rookie, the split should be more interesting in 2018 than it was the split before. Although Mike Young, don't call me Mike Young, Mike Young, was a fantastic story.
One more Mike Young.
Mike Young.
Perfect.
Fidget spinners. We got a fidget spinner.
TSM that. Fidget spinner. We're set.
Oh, you can't really see it. Overlay's coming in. Damn, look at that. It's an overlay. Or a fidget spinner. And an overlay. Let's go to MVP. MVP is the interesting one. Bjergsen obviously has won this award four times. Count them, four times. Anyone else? No one else has won it twice.
Nope.
That's insane.
It's the Bjerger King's reign.
The Bjerger King's reign. So heading into 2018, a totally revamped TSM roster. Is Bjergsen favorite for MVP again? Number five?
He's got to be. He's got to be. Fifth time. It's always going to the GOAT. Bjergsen, he's going to be it. And I'm telling you why. Because he is going to be... performing with this roster that TSM has assembled, they are going to work together so well. It might take a week, it might take 2 weeks, it might even take 4 weeks. But I am going to stake my claim here and say that Bjergsen is going to have a phenomenal season again. Even looking last year during the splits, where he was performing all right and the rest of TSM was maybe a question mark on how they were gelling together and how, you know, Svenskeren was getting caught out. I think that Bjergsen here, working with Mike Young, this young jungler that he has worked with in solo queue, I find that they're going to be a phenomenal pairing, and I think that Hanser, again, is going to show off his spring split style like he did last year, coming close to winning the MVP, and then the bot lane. Mithy and Sven are going to give a level of stability for Bjergsen that he hasn't had with Doublelift and Biofrost. This is the year that Bjergsen really puts his stamp on that MVP for the fifth time.
Yeah, I mean, here's the thing. When Bjergsen is getting MVP, you even look at last year, Jensen, a guy who a lot of people thought should have gotten MVP.
Which is understandable. Jensen put up some pretty wild numbers.
He put some insane numbers. And usually it's when the rest of your team is subpar or, you know, average, nothing great. That's why Jensen was getting all that nod, because that bottom lane on C9 was a little questionable and impact.
Sneaky in lane.
Yeah, he wasn't great in lane for the majority of the regular season. And impact was even questionable. It was basically just contracts. So Jensen was the star, clearly the star, way ahead of everyone. So we got the MVP nods. With this TSM roster, Bjergsen's not going to have that. There's so many other stars on that team. Hanser's a guy who's gotten a lot of MVP nods before. And yeah, Sven and Mithy, that's huge. Mike Young might struggle. You say it might take 1, 2, 4 weeks. It might take them a whole split to get things figured out with this entirely revamped roster. But that's a lot of star power. They're going to be stealing MVP votes from one another. You look a couple splits ago when Doublelift had a fantastic year on TSM. It was neck and neck with Bjergsen and Doublelift. So they're going to be taking votes from one another. So I don't know if Bjergsen's going to get his fifth one in the spring.
I can understand that. I think that that's actually a very good point to bring up. Maybe, you know, kind of the carnivorous style that is going to be there for these MVP votes, that everybody's going to be gunning for them. I still think that with TSM star power, I think that that star power is going to just push Bjergsen to this next level. I think that's why he'll be the MVP. But I can definitely see a case made for, you know, possibly someone like Huni or maybe someone else, you know, on a lesser team, just popping off absolutely and being the star for them and carrying them, you know, to maybe a third or fourth place type of finish. And being, well, that's the reason they're there. That has to be the guy.
Yeah, and I think if it's going to be a mid laner who earns MVP, he's got to have a stud jungler alongside him. Not sure if Mike Young will be that right away. So I'm looking at someone like Svenskeren and Jensen. Maybe Jensen gets MVP this year. Or I'm looking at a guy like Febiven, who's got Lyra in the jungle, his first split in NA. Listen, this guy has shown up on all sorts of stages internationally. The guy's 1v1 Faker. That is how you ascend to greatness, is you 1v1 the god himself. But even last split with H2K, because of all the ridiculous numbers that guys like Reckless were putting up on Fnatic, you didn't really appreciate how great a season Febiven had on that H2K roster. They had a suspect bottom lane for a lot of the year, and he had a very solid jungler in Jankos. I think Lyra has the potential to be even better than Jankos, and working with a mid laner like Febiven, that duo can really showcase what they can do. And I think Febiven and Clutch Gaming We had them power rankings at number 4. I think they can get there, and I think Febiven will be a main reason why, and he'll take MVP.
I think that, and really interesting thing to look at Febiven, and I think maybe the only thing that could possibly hold him back from actually being this MVP that we talk that you're talking about here is the fact that we don't know exactly how he's going to react to coming over to North America and in the North America game. You never know if it's going to be a situation like Yellow Star where it comes in and you just don't quite adapt to it. I don't really have those concerns. I have a lot of faith in Febiven and the type of star player that he really is. He seems to be, to me, other than Jensen and Bjergsen, kind of the only shot to have another absolute all-star mid laner in North America. This is one of those guys that can provide those type of plays that Jensen and Bjergsen have shown off and why they're such household names in the NA LCS. And I think that Febiven really has a chance to do that. And as you said, Lyra is a phenomenal jungler partner to do that. And I think that, yeah, very good pick to possibly be MVP.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, there's the mid lane talent pool is absolutely bonkers in the NA LCS. Most of them not North American, but
nope.
Eh, that's why the talent's so good.
Bjergsen. He's all NA.
He's all NA, even though for the first 17 years of his life when he wasn't.
Those years don't matter anymore. Yeah. It's living the now, living the present.
Life only starts after the age of 17. That is a well-known fact.
Life only starts when you're an NA resident.
That's right. Nothing else matters. But MVP, I mean, it is tougher to pick this year than any other time because
it's a lot of talent in NA now.
How high do you rank where a team finishes? Right. Like, yeah, let's say Huni puts up absolutely absurd numbers. He plays Lucian every game, gets averages 2 pentakills a game. Lucian. But if Echo Fox finishes 8th, can he really be MVP?
It's true. That's probably a tough question to ask. I think when you're bringing up these other MVP names, again, yeah, we do have to think about how they're going to react to the change of scenery, new teammates, different teams, different strategies. Going to be a very interesting MVP race.
Very interesting. Even more interesting is who's going to win the split.
MVP matters, but it really doesn't matter if you're not winning the split.
It's a regular season award. Who cares about the regular season?
Individual. This is a team game.
It's a team game, and teams win the playoffs. TSM won 3 in a row. They've been to 10 straight finals. They've never missed a final.
Nope. They're not going to miss this one.
They're not going to miss
this one.
Telling
you this one, it's going to be 11. TSM is going to make it into the NA Spring Split Finals. I think, we've talked about this. Mike Young, this new bot lane and how everything is going to work. Might take some time. But this is definitely a roster that is far too talented and has too much and too strong of a supporting cast around them with Coach Song, Lustboy coming in from Korea to coach the bot lane. I think that this is going to be TSM's year once again to get into the finals, and who they're going to be playing off against is going to be Counter Logic Gaming, and their former support Biofrost is going to be there with Counter Logic Gaming performing against TSM in the Spring Split Finals, and we are going to have a phenomenal one. It's going to go down to the wire with TSM taking it in game 5.
Wow, TSM taking it in game 5. I believe in CLG. I believe in this man on the screen right now. Huhi, who was the best player on CLG last split. He carried them in the playoffs. He carried them in the regional gauntlet. He carried them for much of the regular season. It was the rest of that CLG roster that was a little suspect. Obviously, Omar God was kind of shafted. He just kind of got thrown into the LCS squad and they're like, okay, go. We're trying to qualify for Worlds. Help us out. Yeah. He kind of got screwed over. He got a lot of harsh criticism, harsh reaction, but he was in a tough spot. Reign over a guy who comes over. This roster is so much better than any of the Team Liquid that he's been on the last year. I think CLG, they might struggle to get things started in the regular season. We've seen them do that over the past many years. They kind of slump their way through the regular season. They've got a lot of stuff to figure out in terms of shot calling with Aframu off the team now. Guy like Darshan's probably going to step up. Hopefully Rainover can fill that role. Hopefully he hasn't been completely tainted and broken by Team Liquid and his time there. But I think CLG overcomes a kind of stretchy regular season and they do the full run, quarterfinals through to the finals. And I think they beat Cloud9 in those finals. TSM doesn't make the finals in the 2018 Spring Split with this stacked roster. People completely lose their mind, call for it to be blown up, and then they'll probably win summer, goes the first seed, into Worlds. But I think it's going to take some time for TSM to figure out what's going on with this roster because there's so many changes.
I think it's important to remember that this is also a TSM roster that is starting to scrim and practice together a full week later than the majority of the rest of the LCS. Reginald gave the rest of the whole team, you know, the extra week off, talked about how they knew that, you know what, when we start, we're going to be rusty in the sense of not knowing exactly, you know, what everyone's thinking on the same page with one to another, you know, making the changes. But it's important to think about that they knew that this was coming and they know that they're going to have these hardships to work through, but they're fully motivated to working through them and finding that synergy for this team. And I think that that is going to be something that really cohesively joins them together and really solidifies their strength together.
Yeah, this team is going to be under the microscope so heavily for the entire year, really.
It's TSM. It's always the big franchise.
This roster, even more so, and there's going to be so much pressure on Mike Young. I'm sure he'll have a few bad games to start the split just because the sheer amount of pressure on him. Even at All-Stars, when he didn't look that great there, people were very unfairly critical of him. It's All-Star. Mm-hmm. It's supposed to be fun.
I think Mike Young will actually, though, benefit from what the meta is going to be for the first couple of weeks. We're going to see some champions that he is strong on being some highly contested picks. The Nidalee, the Kha'Zix, those are some of those aggressive junglers that are in meta right now and are highly contested picks over in Korea that I think we can also see that will be wanted to be played over here in the NA LCS. And I think that those will give Mike Young his comfort zone and allow him to fully impact the map with TSM.
Yeah, I mean, what the meta is definitely going to impact, I think, more so jungling than any other position, just because, I mean, some teams, they're heavily focused on these junglers. Mm-hmm. Like Contracts, for example, on the Guardians, if it's a tank meta, that team is going to struggle because they need Contracts on some carry champions because they don't have carry positions in other spots.
Right.
But playoffs, there's a lot of teams, there's more teams than ever that have a legitimate shot at not only getting to the finals, but potentially winning. Usually, you go into playoffs and even these 3-6 matchups, you're like, okay. You don't really expect a Dignitas to actually beat TSM or anything like that. But I think you can actually say that there's four teams that could win.
Yeah, there's a lot of pressure on these teams. And when you're talking also, when you're looking at these, you know, kind of dark horse teams and talking about, are they going to figure it out? And if they do, how strong that they can be, teams such as Clutch Gaming and Echo Fox. If you're looking at that Echo Fox roster, a lot of individual talent, but also very volatile. And if it doesn't all work, it's a total mess. But if it works, this could be a really strong, really talented roster. And you never know how that's all going to shape out in the rest of the LCS season.
Absolutely. And in terms of CLG, I just think they're one of the teams that prepare the best with Coach Zeke's on there. They just prepare so well, especially for best of series. Best of ones, you'd think that'd be good for them because, you know, they like to hype up their level ones. But I don't know how often that actually fully affects a game unless the other team makes a big error. You're not going to get three kills level one or a huge advantage. But in terms of best of series, I just think CLG prepares super well for these playoffs, boot camps well, and they do the full run, quarterfinals through it all. They're not getting a bye, but they're going to make the full run through.
I think absolutely in the first couple of weeks of the split that we're going to see a heavy emphasis on preparation. And I think that's where CLG really does benefit from Coach Zeke's, is because he, if not the best coach in North America, he's the best North American coach. And so I think
that's what, 10%, 20% of the teams?
Okay. Hey, it's still a feather in his cap, okay?
True.
But I think that when you're talking about preparation, it's going to be so important with all these changes that's going on, everyone, new faces and new places. The preparation is going to be absolutely crucial, and these teams that have these coaching staffs and support behind them, I think that they're going to find early success this split.
All right. Okay, quickly, week one matchups. There's plenty of fantastic matchups to look forward to. Which one are you most excited for, and why is it Echo Fox FlyQuest? Can't wait!
That's probably, without a doubt, the matchup I'm least excited about.
Without a doubt. That was clearly, they had storylines in play for 8 of the 10 teams, and they're like, oh, we have 2 left. Echo Fox and FlyQuest.
Love me some Rick Fox, Echo Fox, love me Hooney. And hey, props to FlyQuest for getting 5-Hour Energy and Snickers as big sponsors for them. Hey, bringing in that cash. Love it.
Love
Snickers. Just not really all that interested in watching your matchup compared to the other ones. I think TSM TL is absolutely the top on most people's things. Seeing the revenge story double lift in again, you're obviously seeing the rest of the additions for Team Liquid, and just that story again against TSM is going to be great. But the one that I'm really, really excited about, a little bit of fresh blood into the NALCS, I'm excited to see Optic Gaming and 100 Thieves. I think Nadeshot has brought a lot of excitement and effort and passion into his brand, into the NALCS, and I'm really excited to see that go up against the Green Wall. Even if they might be my 10th place team, I think that 100,
they look like it.
I think 100 Thieves and Optic will be a very cool match to see.
And if you're a big basketball fan, you got Clutch Gaming and the Golden Guardians. Warriors, Rockets!
It's great. We can talk about all these NBA matchups every week now. We NBA now.
Who would be better at League of Legends, James Harden or Steph Curry?
Ooh. James Harden has that beard, and I think that there's a lot of people playing League of Legends that have beards. Yeah. I don't know if that's going to help him too much. Steph Curry's too athletic. You got to be more.
He's too athletic.
Got to be more in your seat. You know.
Yeah. I mean, Steph Curry's good at cooking, so does that translate to League at all? Mechanics.
Hand-eye coordination skills.
He's got mechanics.
Possibly.
There.
Who knows?
Yeah, so my money's on Steph there. Make sure to like, comment, and subscribe for more esports content.